Okay, it's time to get started. It's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Charles Gammy. Charles got his bachelor's degree from Yale, majored in math in 1987. That's why he's so good at math, and he looks very good at math.
What's the distinguishing feature?
He then moved to Princeton as a graduate student and obtained his PhD in 1991, supervised by Jeremy Goodman. He was then moved to Virginia Institute for Theoretical Astrophysics. And I believe this must be a very exciting time for Charles because he worked with Steve Balbus and John Hawley on the newly discovered magnetorotational instability. And they pioneered on the numerical study of this MRI. He then moved to CFA, mostly in the theory division and later in the radio division, where he mainly worked with Ramesh Narayan. He continued to work on quite a bit on the MRI physics and also did a lot of work model different types of accretion disks. And then in 1999, he joined the faculty at University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. And after that, he was on a track of continuous promotion, where he's now the chair of the astronomy department. So Charles has very broad research interest in theoretical astrophysics, especially on astrophysical fluid dynamics. He has done influential works, both analytically and numerically, on quite different types of accretion disks, from the very weakly ionized protostellar disks to the hot accretion flows around black hole accretion disks and the self-gravitating disks, as well as radiation-dominated disks. And in order to achieve that, Charles is also pioneering on the development of numerical methods to solve complex astrophysical fluid dynamics problems. He was one of the inventors of the Schoenbox technique, which studies just a local patch of accretion disks. And this has later produced hundreds, if not thousands, of papers. And he was also one of the main developers of the GR-MHD code HARM, and which has been later widely used, especially in the research group of Ramesh Narayan. And so his more recent research interest is mainly in black hole accretion disk, which is what he's going to talk about today. So Charles, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Shuining. That was very nice. I'm getting old enough that I don't recognize the guy who's being introduced anymore. So the one correction is that I'm no longer chair of the department. So I identified an excellent successor. I'm going to talk today about models of black hole accretion, but this is really a talk about the galactic center and preparation for results from a Event Horizon telescope. And this is work that I've done with several students, several generations of students. So Hotaka Shikawa, whose name I saw on a door over at 160 Garden Street today, and Josh Dolenz, who's now at Los Alamos, Mani Chandra, who's his email is manic. he's a current student at Illinois, and Ben Ryan, who's also a current student. And this work is sponsored by the NSF in Computational and Theoretical Astrophysics Network in collaboration with Jim Stone and Elliot Quadier. Okay, so here's the plan of action. I'm going to start with a discussion of the galactic center, an overview of the galactic center that takes us from Earth down to the center of the galaxy. And then I'll give sort of a non-technical discussion of models of accretion onto black holes at low accretion rates. And then talk about a specific problem that arises in this context, which has to do with black hole accretion disks whose angular momentum is tilted with respect to the spin of the black hole. And then the last bit is about sort of what the future holds in this business. Okay, so here is my overview of the galactic center, and I'll I'll go through this in some detail. So let's start with the labels on this plot. So this shows distance from the center of the galaxy, which is where all distances should be measured from, in units of gm over c squared. And then a little further down here, I have the same distances measured in angular size. So 1 degree here down to 5 microarcseconds, which is corresponds to gm over c squared for the galactic center black hole. And then down here, the distances in physical units. So 6 10 to the 11 centimeters is a characteristic size for the galactic center black hole. And then one astronomical unit lies out here at a few tens of m, and one parsec out here at millions of m. OK, so I'm going to start where we are, which is out here at 4 10 to the 10 gravitational radii from the black hole. This is Champaign-Urbana. This is my favorite place in downtown Champaign, and I'd be happy to take any visitors there when you come out. So here we are at 4 10 to the 10 gm over c squared from the central black hole. And if we go in by a factor of 1,000 in distance, we reach the, almost 1,000, 100 in distance, we reach the central molecular zone. And some people here have been pioneers in this this business. Tony Stark, I see over here. So here's a map of the central molecular zone. This is the MOPRA survey of in several different lines. And the scale here is of order degrees or of order hundreds of parsecs. So this is an enormous molecular cloud in the galactic center. The mass of this thing is at least 10 to the 7 solar masses. And all this is inside a scale that would be less than angular size of less than 1 arcsecond at 30 megaparsecs. So this would be largely unresolved. So the mass of this molecular gas exceeds the mass of the central black hole, which is believed to be about 4 million solar masses. OK, moving in further still, we reach the circumnuclear disk and the mini spiral. So this is a molecular material, and this is ionized gas. And I've got an image here. So the colors show HCN, so this is the molecular gas, and we're well inside the central molecular zone now. This is a local product, SMA observation, and then the ionized gas is shown here as contour, so that's 6 centimeter data. Okay. so I think one of the points I'm trying to make here, in case you're wondering why I'm giving you this tour, is that there's an enormous amount of structure inside an enormous range and radius inside a region that's unresolved on an extragalactic scale. Okay, so yet further in is a recently discovered pulsar, J1745. So here's the discovery paper. And one of the reasons this pulsar is interesting for galactic center study is because it gives us information about magnetic field strengths in the galactic center. So this lies at an angular separation of about 3 arcseconds, I believe, from the center of the galaxy, and tells us about magnetic field strengths at that scale. But that's still outside the Bondi radius, which is at of order 1 arcsecond. I just want to comment that the Bondi radius is the characteristic radius where the binding energy of the gas exceeds the thermal energy. But it does not mean that there's a Bondi inflow at the Bondi radius. And in fact, in the galactic center, there may be an outflow at the Bondi radius. So the Bondi radius is sort of a spherical cow. You should not have the idea this is a Russian spherical cow. So it has axis labels. So you should not have the idea that there's a smooth inflow at that radius just because the flow is unresolved. Okay, still further in are the famous S stars. I think it's called S for Schnell. These are fast-moving stars. This is, of course, very famous work that I probably don't need to introduce much. So this shows the orbit of some of these bright stars seen in the infrared in the galactic center, whose orbits one can trace on the sky and whose velocities one can measure. And from those measurements, obtain a constraint on both the mass of the central black hole and the distance to the galactic center. And actually a very strong constraint on the ratio of those two quantities, mass divided by distance, which is constrained to about 5%. That is related to the angular size of the black hole. Okay, so further in yet lies the resolution that can be achieved with the Event Horizon Telescope. So this is sort of bringing coals to Newcastle, but Event Horizon Telescope is a millimeter planned millimeter VLBI network that will be able to, we hope, make an image of the accretion flow around the central black hole. And it's being directed now by Shep Dolman, who's across the street and is maybe here today. Is Shep? No, Shep isn't here. Okay. There has been millimeter VLBI measurements made of the galactic center source. This is 1.3 millimeter data, and it shows a scale for the central source. So one obtains visibilities on a small sample of baselines, and one finds that one can fit this with a Gaussian, and that the characteristic width, full width at half maximum, is about 40 microarc seconds. And this corresponds to about 8 gm over c squared. So it's incredibly high angular resolution. These results are from, I believe, three baselines, three stations. And I think this is JCMT plus KARMA plus Arizona Radio Observatory. But in the future, it will be possible to use a much larger network of millimeter antennas. So let's see if I can, there we go. So this is provided by Laura here. So it shows the location of the stations that we hope will be in the Event Horizon Telescope network on the left, as seen from the center of the galaxy. And on the right, one sees the tracks that these baselines will make in the UV plane, in the Fourier transform of the sky. So so far, the detections have involved a small number of baselines to Hawaii, but once north-south baselines are added, we'll get a lot more information about the structure, the spatial structure of the galactic center source. And we'll be able to make a picture, and I can't resist showing you a preview of this. So I'll come back to this. I saw the movie. Have you seen the movie? Okay, great. The visuals are great, and the images of the hole are scientifically accurate, as you'll see in a moment. Okay, so it's not going to look like that. It's going to look something like this. These are simulated images from a paper this year by Vincent Fish and collaborators. So this shows on the left a model of this is an analytic model of the galactic center. And you can see that it's got a bright edge on one side. And this arises because the plasma that's producing this synchrotron emission is orbiting toward us on one side of the black hole. And so emission on one side is Doppler boosted, and emission on the other side is Doppler dimmed. The size of this is sometimes referred to as the shadow of the black hole. The size of this shadow significantly exceeds the size that you would estimate by just taking GM over C squared D. So that ratio is about 5 microarc seconds. The diameter of this thing is 50 microarc seconds, and the increase in size is due to strong gravitational lensing in the neighborhood of the black hole. So lensing helps us and increases the angular size of the event horizon. So this is a model. And unfortunately, this model has to be processed as the millimeter waves travel through the intervening interstellar electrons. And there's interstellar scattering, which produces an image that looks something like this. So the size of the scatter broadening kernel is comparable to the size of the event horizon at 1 millimeter, and it goes away as lambda squared. So at shorter wavelength, it shouldn't be important. So this shows a series of images that are treated using different processing algorithms. So this is the raw image that one would expect when this is convolved with the interstellar scattering kernel. And this shows a reconstructed image. I believe this is using maximum entropy method. And then this shows the same image with the interstellar scattering deconvolved away. And you can see that it is possible to see in this deconvolved image the shadow of the event horizon. And one of the major motivations for the event horizon telescope is to measure the angular diameter of that event horizon and see if it is what we expect based on constraints from the stellar orbit data. So that tells us M over D. This will give us another estimate for M over D, if general relativity is correct. Tony?
Is this picture an RA index?
I don't know the answer. Ramesh, he doesn't know the answer either. Yeah. Yeah.
But that's about the right angle for the plane.
Yeah, there's no particular reason to think that the flow should be lined up with the galactic plane. Mm. It would be surprising even if it were lined up with the galactic plane. Okay, so that explains the motivation for modeling the galactic center. So that gives us the EHT observations will give us information about this inner region close to the event horizon. So motivated by this, we built fully relativistic models of the galactic center. And these are useful, I think, not just for studying the galactic center, but also other low accretion rate systems like M87 and M31 has a similar accretion rate in Eddington units. M32. Most central black holes are in fact seem to be accreting at low rates, and therefore in this regime of this low accretion rate regime, which I'll say more about in a moment. Okay, so to build models that anticipate what Event Horizon Telescope will see, we need a model for the accreting plasma. And then we needed a model for the emergent radiation. And for the accreting plasma, we've built fully relativistic MHD models. So this is old news, but I need to explain it for what follows. So we use an ideal MHD model, and we treat the accreting plasma as a fluid, which is probably the worst approximation that we make in the whole business at step one. Because the accreting plasma is likely to be in a regime, low density and high temperature, where it's approximately collisionless. So Coulomb interactions between ions and electrons and electrons, are insufficient to produce a thermal distribution and to keep the electrons and ions at the same temperature. Okay, so that's true confessions. And I'll come back to this in a moment. Our models are fully relativistic, so we make no assumptions, we make no expansions in V over C, and we use a Kerr metric to describe the gravitational potential, which includes the possibility of black hole spin. Most of the models I'm going to show you are non-radiative. So the galactic center is in this regime, whose study was pioneered by Ramesh, where the cooling time of a parcel of gas vastly exceeds the time required for it to accrete onto the black hole. So accretion energy that's deposited as internal energy in the plasma is simply carried across the event horizon. And we can simply evolve the plasma without taking any consideration of the interaction with the radiation field. And this code, which Schwenning mentioned in his introduction, is called HARM, and now is widely used in studies of black hole accretion. Okay, so so let me show you an example of the kind of calculation we do. So this is, of course, I'm showing you the best example. This is a section through the equatorial plane of a 3D model in which the accretion disk is aligned with the spin of the black hole. And the colors in this model show density. And this is the initial state, which was set up and run by my student Hotaka Shikawa. So in this initial state, which we set up simply for numerical convenience, we have a torus of material which is orbiting the central black hole, and it's an exact hydrodynamic equilibrium. But then we seed it with a magnetic field, and the magnetic field causes an instability to grow, the magnetorotational instability, and that allows accretion to occur onto the hole. So you'll see that in just a moment. Okay, so there's a spinning black hole in the middle, and this inner boundary condition, it's actually placed inside the event horizon, so it's causally disconnected from the rest of the flow. And and the outer boundary condition here is at about 40 gm over c squared. And we focus on this small region because almost all the emitted radiation comes from within a few gm over c squared of the event horizon at all frequencies from millimeter up to, we believe, the X-ray flares. Okay, so you can see that there are non-axisymmetric structures that develop in the course of this turbulence. And you can also see that the colors are changing. So the entire disk is draining out into the black hole. Okay, so the colors here, I should say, showed the logarithm of the rest mass density. And the time up at the top was in units of GM over C squared, which is about 20 seconds for the central black hole. Okay, so let me go on. So that's the dynamical model. That's that gives us magnetic fields, densities, and temperatures in the accreting plasma. And then we have a radiative model on top of that, which we run as a post-processing step. So we calculate the emergent radiation after this million-hour run is done. And this is a fairly numerically inexpensive part of the business. So our radiative model is fully relativistic. And by that, what I mean, well, let's see, I went the wrong way. By that, what I mean is that we track photons along geodesics, rather than assuming that they move on straight lines. So this is an example that shows the importance of this effect in these calculations. This shows radiation emitted isotropically from a particle which is on the innermost stable circular orbit around the event around the black hole, which has an event horizon which lies right about here. So we're looking down the spin axis of the black hole. And this shows the photon trajectory is projected into this plane where the units are GM over C squared. So this guy is going around in this direction, and the photons are beamed forward along the orbit, and then their trajectories are lensed by the in the gravitational potential of the black hole. So you can see from this sample of photon trajectories that things are beamed forward. You can also see a tight little circle here of trajectories that follow what is referred to as a photon orbit around the black hole. So this is a location where photons can circle the black hole many times, potentially, although it's an unstable orbit. Okay, so that will come back later in the discussion. So it's important that we use a fully relativistic scheme because most of the radiation that's seen in the millimeter, the infrared, the X-ray, presumably arises quite close to the innermost stable circular orbit. Okay, so there's some radiation physics that also has to go into this. So we include synchrotron emission and absorption. And of course, the emissivity coefficients for that depend on the electron distribution function. So each electron radiates at a characteristic frequency, which is proportional to the square of its Lorentz factor multiplied by the gyro frequency. And so the distribution of electrons over Lorentz factor controls the emissivity. So it's important to understand what the electron distribution function is. We have taken a shortcut where we assume that they're simply thermal. And that's one of the most important assumptions that needs to be lifted in the future. So we also include the effects of Compton scattering, which is important for X-rays, for the X-ray portion of the galactic center spectrum. And all this stuff is included in our set of codes that do this radiative post-processing. And the result is this, and I'll show this movie in just a moment, but you can see there's a sort of a bright ring on the sky here, which I earlier described as the shadow of the black hole. Well, the edge of that shadow corresponds to trajectories, to geodesics, that have come off the photon orbit or close to the photon orbit. So they've curved around the black hole, and they've had a long path length through the emitting plasma. So the intensity on those trajectories is high. Okay, and the this plot shows a color, which is the log of the intensity on the sky at 1.3 millimeters. Okay, so the black hole spin points up, and we're looking at the disk essentially edge on. And you can see that this side of the disk is moving toward us, and this side is moving away from us. And there's this time-steady ring corresponding to the photon orbit on the sky, which is unfortunately small compared to the interstellar scattering kernel. You can also see inhomogeneities in the accretion flow, which correspond for the most part to magnetic field fluctuations. So when the field fluctuates, it changes the synchrotron emissivity. And those magnetic field fluctuations are being advected with the disk as it orbits the black hole. Okay, and you can also see some faint emission along the edges of a jet here. So there's a pointing jet that emerges from over the poles of the black hole. But this emission is very faint in comparison to this in this particular model. In other models, it is not, and I'll come back to that. Okay, so it actually does look a little like that, doesn't it? So they should have called me. Okay, so from this model, we can also calculate a spectrum. And this shows spectra of the model at different inclinations of the disk and the black hole. And this axis here is nu L nu in units of ergs per second. So a few 10 to the 35 seems to be the peak measured nu L nu of the galactic center and the submillimeter. And then there are three different models here. But I'd like you to just, for now, focus on the black model, which goes up in the submillimeter where the peak of the synchrotron spectrum is. So those are photons produced by direct synchrotron emission within about 10 m of the black hole. And then there's a second peak out here extending into the X-ray band, which is here, where these bow ties are. And this is singly Compton scattered. These are singly Compton scattered, upscattered synchrotron photons. Okay, so you can see that this model goes underneath the infrared points. So these are the infrared flares. And it's sort of close, sort of uncomfortably close to the quiescent X-ray points. Okay, so where does the emission come from? What radius does it come from? I claim that it came from close to the black hole. In this plot, again, just follow the black line for now, which is our untilted disk model. We've taken the mean radius of emission as a function of frequency in units of m. So the event horizon is here, and the innermost stable circular orbit for this model is here. So this is a black hole with spin of 0.93. And you can see that the radius of emission goes down as the frequency goes up. And at 230 gigahertz is about here. So that's at about 8m. But as one goes into the infrared, one gets very close to the innermost stable circular orbit. And the same is true again for the X-ray, the Comptonized X-ray photons there. So those also arise very close to the event horizon. Okay, so we've got models of the source. We can produce spectra, we can produce simulated images. What should you believe about this? And in thinking about that, one of the first questions you might ask is, what are the parameters of the model? And there are a lot of them. So in particular, we have to set the black hole mass and distance. But those we know to excellent accuracy for Sagittarius star. We also have to set an accretion rate. And we use the 1.3 millimeter flux to do that. So we can scale the accretion rate up and down in the models. And we scale it until we match the observed few Jansky flux in the millimeter. There's also an ion to electron temperature ratio, which I have hidden from you so far. And we assume that this ratio is constant in the models. But we can fix this parameter through the Event Horizon Telescope observations. They tell us the size of the source. We know the flux, and therefore we know the temperature of the electrons. So this ratio is then fixed by EHT results. And then there's an inclination of the source, position angle on the sky, which Tony alluded to earlier, and possibly the presence of a mean magnetic field, which can sharply change the model. So there are strong vertical field models, models in which a magnetic field threads the entire disk that Ramesh and Ramesh's group has worked on. And these are called magnetically arrested disks, or MAD models. And what I have showed you so far are what are referred to as standard and normal evolution models, or SANE models. The MAD models may be right. Okay, and then another possibility is that the disk is tilted. So there's no particular reason for the angular momentum of the accretion flow to be aligned with the spin of the black hole. So we've spent some time looking at that, and I'll show you some results from that work. This shows initial conditions for a tilted disk model in three dimensions. So this is work by Hotaka Shikawa. And this shows the spin axis of the black hole here, and then a section through a three-dimensional disk here. And you can see, obviously, that the disk is tilted. We can run this forward in time and look at isodensity contours of the flow. And this is a nice, beautiful image that Hotaka made. And this shows the main feature of the tilted disk models, which is a two-arm spiral driven just outside the innermost stable circular orbit. And the amplitude of this spiral looks enormous here, but the isodensity contour has just been selected to really show the two-arm spiral. It's actually a 20 or 30% amplitude spiral wave. So this does, however, have a substantial impact on the spectrum. Okay, but before I go to that, let me just show you what this looks like. So we're looking at one of these models at this is at 3 terahertz, and we're sort of walking around it. So you can see these two-arm spirals appearing in the lensed image as some kind of, you know, funky spiral on the sky. And again, you can see this sort of permanent feature attached to the photon orbit around the black hole. And in this, at this frequency, the jet is much more prominent. So there's high temperature material along the walls of the jet, which points normal to the disk, and that produces this high frequency emission. Okay, so so what do the spectra of those models look like? Well, this is the same plot I showed you before, but now I'm prepared to tell you what these three curves are. The black curve is an untilted disk model, and then the red and the green curves are progressively more tilted disk models. So the first one is tilted at 15 degrees, and the next one is tilted at 30 degrees. So they drive progressively stronger two-arm spirals in the inner disk where most of the emission arises. Okay, so that has a profound effect on the spectrum. So we've normalized these things by requiring that they give the right 1.3 millimeter flux. But you can see that as we tilt the disk, we're getting more and more emission in the infrared. And in fact, we're getting too much infrared emission here. So this exceeds the steady infrared emission limits from observations. And we're also getting more and more Comptonized photons in the X-ray. And again, for the 30 degree tilt disk, we're getting more than are allowed by the observations for a steady flow. So there's a signature of tilt buried in the spectrum. And the signature is a change of the infrared to millimeter and X-ray to millimeter colors. Okay, so I said earlier that we had committed our greatest sin by using a fluid model, and that's absolutely the case. And the key problem now, I think, in this field is a question that's familiar from cosmology, which is, does the light trace the mass? And in particular, do the energetic electrons trace the location of the ions? And so what is the distribution of electron energies? And to pursue that question, we need to put some plasma physics into the models. We need electron physics. So some of the things one might think about trying to put into this model, because I do not think it's possible to run a full-up plasma direct simulation of this flow. It's simply too expensive. Are separate ion and electron equations of state, separate ion and electron conduction. So in this flow, the mean free path for an electron is something like 10 to the 5 gm over c squared. So that implies that thermal conduction is going to be potentially significant if there are not collective effects that limit the mean free path of the electrons and ions. So I'll show you next effort to include conduction. One might also think about including viscosity, which is closely related to anisotropic pressure. So in this collisionless plasma, there's no particular reason that the temperature along the field lines should be the same as the temperature perpendicular to the field lines. And if one includes that effect, it could have profound effects on the dynamics. And then perhaps most important of all, one would like a model for apportioning the heating, the dissipation of magnetic and fluid kinetic energy into the ions and electrons to self-consistently determine the electron energy, integrated energy. So as an approach to this business, we've created a code called GRIM, which stands for General Relativistic Implicit MHD. And this is Mani's thesis work. But before I go into that, I just want to show how important this business of light tracing the mass can be. So this shows two models that are quite similar to what I've showed you already, but two models that make different assumptions about the electron temperature in different parts of the flow. So the top series of models has assumed that the disk is hot and the jet area is cold. So that's essentially what I've assumed so far. And then the second row of models assumes that the disk is cold, but that the electron temperature in the jet region is high. And you can see that that changes the centroid of emission, especially longward of 1.3 millimeters. So at 7 millimeters, the effect is quite dramatic. At 7 millimeters, all the emission arises in the jet down here, and all of the emission arises in the disk up here. Okay. So I'll describe a little bit of preliminary work on this Grimm code next. But I just want to persuade you that electron conduction is potentially important in these flows. So the usual estimate one makes is that the conductive heat flux is something like the pressure multiplied by the sound speed and divided by a characteristic scale in the flow, which might be of order of the radius. One can compare that to the internal energy to get a time scale for conductive changes in internal energy. And that ratio is the sound crossing time when the flow is essentially collisionless. And in this case, the sound speed is close to the speed of light. So this suggests that conduction could change the energy of the plasma on of order the light crossing time. And so it's potentially quite an important effect. Now, in a collisionless flow like this, conduction only happens along the magnetic field lines. So the electrons and ions spiral around the field lines, and then they have sort of unlimited excursions parallel to the field. And we've written a model which incorporates this effect in a fully relativistic way, which turned out to be surprisingly challenging because standard models of heat conduction, something called the Eckart model, which is what you'll find in MTW if you look, is unstable. So one has to write a stable version of the theory, and that's something that a lot of people have worked on in the last 20 years. So we've coded this up, and you can see here the temperature as color and in a little periodic box model. And superposed on this are magnetic field lines that we've just made wave around a bit. And then we turn this on, we expect conduction to occur along field lines. And eventually cause the temperature to reach equilibrium along the field lines. And lo and behold, it does. So there's a slight coupling to compressive modes, and you can see that in those waves moving around, which gives you a hint as to what the sound speed is. And you can see that the temperature changes on of order the sound crossing time in this model, and that the conduction does indeed follow the field lines. So this is the sort of physics I think is, at least has to be explored in trying to build up predictive models for Sagittarius A star. And then this is a little bit technical, but this is sort of done for bragging rights. So this shows another test that we ran. And it turns out when you have anisotropic conduction like this, there's an instability of a temperature stratified atmosphere called the magnetothermal instability. It's a variety of convection driven by a temperature gradient. And it's most pronounced when you have a horizontal magnetic field and then, of course, temperature dropping outward. There's another variety, there's a variant on this instability that arises when the temperature increases outward. So it wants to produce a uniform temperature distribution. So this shows a model like our atmosphere model, in which there's a solid boundary. Here's my pointer. A solid boundary here, and a solid boundary here. This is axisymmetric, and we put a weak magnetic field in that follows lines of constant longitude. Okay. So it has not escaped my attention that there's a line of monopoles here at the poles, but don't worry about that. So this has a temperature gradient. Temperature drops outward, and we let it go, and we expect to see this instability, this magnetothermal instability, develop in this weakly relativistic context. So on the left, you can see the density contours, and on the right, the magnetic field streamlines. And indeed, the instability is present, and the growth rates match expectations from linear theory. We also find the other, there's another instability called HBI, which is also seen in a similar set of models. Okay, so I have a habit of getting ahead of myself in talks. So this is the summary. So the first point is that we've built dynamical and radiative models of low accretion rate black holes, motivated largely by a desire to anticipate event horizon telescope results. And I think one of the most useful features of the numerical models is going to be that they will help us understand the effects of time variability of the galactic center source on event horizon telescope imaging. We've also explored the consequences of tilt of the accretion flow, and there's a signature of that in the spectrum. It changes the infrared to millimeter and X-ray to millimeter colors. And in the future, we expect to build extended MHD models, which include effects like conduction and also include anisotropic pressure and separate ion and electron energy equations. And that is work that we're doing in collaboration with Jim Stone and Elliot Quadiert. Thank you very much.
First, the comment, and then comment about interstellar. The spin parameter had to be 0.9999 in order for the time dilation shown. And the images
to be outside the innermost stable circular orbit.
But the
images show you a long way away.
Exactly. So yeah. The images were actually for spin and a half, which therefore there is.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Okay. But the question.
It's shocking, really.
Do you anticipate that including conduction would change dramatically the level of outflow? Because basically you are transferring energy from close to the black hole to far away, where it's more than the binding energy of the gas. Do you expect that to happen?
Yeah, so it depends partly on the structure of the magnetic field lines. So you expect that transfer to be most efficient when there are field lines that are embedded deep in the hot parts of flow, that then go out to larger radius. And that happens primarily near the poles, so in the sort of Arctic and Antarctic regions, which are warm in this case. I think that the an additional effect of conduction is going to be to heat regions at high latitude. So I'm expecting we're going to get cool disks and hot coronae, and so that may help in driving an outflow. Yeah.
Yeah, so
this isn't about interstellar.
No, not interstellar. No. One question directly on your summary. So the tilt, you showed us what tilt does, and basically it increased both the infrared and X-rays, and it looked like some of your tilted models were pretty much fitting the flare data. Is it conceivable that the flares are just temporary tilts in the accretion disk?
I don't think so. So the timescale of the flares is hours, maybe 100 minutes, maybe 200 minutes. So you would have to change the tilt of the disk on that timescale. We haven't explored that question directly because we always normalize the models to the 1 millimeter flux. But I suspect that the variation in the millimeter flux would be huge. So if we fixed the density parameter and then tilted the disk, I think we'd get a big event.
I had another question. So early on, you showed as a function of the observing band, what is the radius from which one is receiving the radiation, right? And it looked like everything was kind of stopping at the ISCO. There's nothing going below the ISCO.
Yeah.
So what's going on? Because as you know, when you look at the simulations, the dynamics doesn't show too much effect at the ISCO. But you're saying that the radiation does?
It's optics. I think the fluid accelerates toward the black hole inside the ISCO. And so the radiation is beamed down into the hole. So you quickly lose power, even though it's the hottest part of the flow and the strongest magnetic fields.
It's all going into the
hole. Yeah, all the photons.
Yes.
Following up on what Ramesh just said, do the infrared and the millimeter colors hold for the variability as well as the continuum?
Let me give a little discussion of the infrared because I know you're interested in this. The infrared flares are not well modeled here, so we don't produce infrared flares of the amplitude that are seen in the observations, and the spectrum isn't right. So the spectrum is fairly flat, and the nu L nu is fairly flat.
It's going up.
Yeah. So I think a lot of people have looked at this. We've looked at this. If you put a few percent of the electrons into a power law tail, you can easily produce the infrared emission. And so the idea is that there's probably some combination of enhanced variability due to those power law tails being present at many locations in the disk, and also enhanced variability due to acceleration. Time variable acceleration
is
electrons.
Throughout the disk rather than, say, just the inner edges or inner ring?
What's throughout the... So you mean the flares?
Yeah, the flares. Uh-huh.
Well, even if you put the power law tail in, the emission comes predominantly from the inner parts of the disk.
Inner parts, yeah. What about, now just a second to follow up again, what about the delay? Can you say anything about whether there's a delay between the infrared, the millimeter, or the X-ray, or anything like this?
It's been a while now. I think since we looked at this, I think the result was that the infrared variability in our model, which again do not produce the flares, is not very different in the infrared and the X-ray. In other words, there's no sort of interesting offset in the center time of the flares. Yeah. You know, we can cross-correlate, and there's no offset. The regions that produce the X-ray emission and the infrared emission in the models are slightly different. So the infrared tends to be concentrated deeper in the disk, even when we add in that power law tail, whereas the X-ray is produced by Compton upscattering, and so it's produced along as photons travel through the bulk of the disk out at 6, 7, 8 GM over C squared. So they're slightly different regions producing those two bands.
There's a question.
In the square box model you showed where you had imposed a sinusoidal magnetic field across the screen, I noticed towards the end of that video you had basically oscillations, I think, up and down of the temperature profile relative to the magnetic field. I'm not sure if I'm saying that exactly the right way. and it seemed like the sort of waves in the blue.
Driving
that and coming back and forth.
So our initial perturbation couples to sound waves slightly. And that's a consequence of the causal nature of the viscosity that we've used. So that excites low amplitude acoustic, or MHD. Actually, in this case, the field is very weak, so they're really just acoustic waves.
Okay. Yeah. So those waves, I noticed it looked like they were hitting the boundary and then coming back.
It was periodic boundary conditions, so they cross the boundaries and then appear to come in from the other side.
But do you expect that in a realistic, non-periodic?
So that's just a test problem to show off the the anisotropic conduction.
So what are the interesting timescales for the observing cadence for the EHT? I mean, it's logistically difficult to do this. So what should we be trying to do in terms of measuring on multiple timescales?
I think everything that can be done is going to be done, given the difficulties of the scheduling. Our models really don't speak to variability on very long timescales. So that depends.
But very long is months or something.
So that model runs for about 30 hours.
Yeah.
So people have run longer models, people sitting in this room right next to you. And and people have also run models with a larger dynamic range and radius, and you have to do that to understand the variability on longer time scales. So we don't have too much to say. I personally don't have much to say about that. I think the interesting thing for EHT here is that there is variability on short time scales that are short compared to a single day of observations. So usually the assumption that's made in creating these images is that the source is time invariant. And so that poses a real challenge for EHT. And people are working on that, right? Yeah.
Modulation between the observing parameters that vary by 24 hours and the actual stuff going on in the black hole.
Yeah, so I think you'll be lucky to get 3 days in a row, right? Does anyone from EHT want to comment on that? Yeah, I think you'll be lucky to get 3 days in a row. So it's not as if this is going to be running for months. There'll be maybe a couple week campaign, and get lucky to get 3 days.
Yes.
Is there any way you can test your models against other objects in the universe, like neutron stars or non-relativistic things?
Right. So. I guess the couple answers to that. So one is that neutron stars are a little more challenging because you have a surface that the plasma falls in onto, and then you produce a lot of radiation which can interact strongly with the flow. So it's sort of a radiation MHD problem, at least even in modest accretion rates. Way of thinking about that would be to ask the question, how well do we understand the accretion process itself? And I think there's a lot of interesting activity going on in modeling other disk systems. So we have some model for turbulence here, the numerical model. Is that right? And I think that numerical model is essentially identical to the models that people are using to model. That's a lot of modeling. to model cataclysmic variable disks and outbursts in cataclysmic variable systems. So my guess is that the best test of disk turbulence theory is going to come from those cataclysmic variables. So you can look at changes on fairly short timescales, dramatic changes in the temperature of the disk, dramatic changes in the efficiency of angular momentum transport. And it'd be interesting to see if the numerical models work.
Yeah, well, kind of along those lines. there's quite a large number of quiescent black holes with measured black hole masses and high resolution Chandra, Hubble, and Spitzer and so on observations. So the spectral predictions might be the path forward to large samples, right?
Yeah. Yes. So I would say that you know, we haven't made a great effort to match every point on the spectrum. We've really been focused on matching the Sagittarius A star results because we know more about that black hole than any other black hole. I think if we were trying to match the spectrum, we would worry a lot more about the power law tail in the electron spectrum and the consequences of that. Yeah. There are just a lot of free parameters, Martin. Yeah. So it's not very well constrained.
In matching the black hole parameters in the accretion disk with the models, will you also be able to say something about the foreground screen of scattered electrons along the line of sight? In terms of a comparison between the model and the observations.
Will we be able to say something about the foreground screen? You know, I think that's a topic of current research. In fact, some of us have a proposal in to look at that right now. So if you're serving on an NSF panel,
it's
an essential project. There may be information about the screen.
If there are no more questions, let's thank Charles again.